when I wake up in the morning, love, and the sunlight hurts my eyes, and something without warning, love, bears heavy on my mind. Then I look at you, and the world's all right with me. Just one look at you, and I know it's gonna be a lovely day.
Good morning. This is State of the Arts NYC, and this is your host, Savona Bailey-McClain. Today, we are in the studio, and we are going to be talking to Allison Wucher. And Allison is the director of Master Drawings New York. And I just want to thank her for coming into the studio today. So thank you so much, Allison.
Thanks for having me.
And Master Drawings is this wonderful U.S.-U.K. collaboration. I like it very much because New Yorkers will get the opportunity to see a lot of works on paper and other special paintings by European masters, 18th, 19th century, that they would not ordinarily get to see up close. You can see them in museums, but during this particular series, you get to see it up close. And I like that very much. It's a series on the Upper East Side with several galleries, and it starts this weekend. So this is which rendition? 10th, 11th?
13th.
13th edition of Master's Drawings New York. So we're going to get ready and start with Allison to tell us, how did this all begin, Master's Drawing?
Well, 13 years ago, Chris Bean Riley Smith, who's a UK-based dealer, and Margo Gordon, who's a New York-based dealer, decided to really start something in New York that was similar to something that Chris Bean had started in London, which is called Master Drawings London. So it really kind of became a dealer-started event that, you know, really tried to give dealers based in New York a platform to show their artworks. And during this week in January, which is really an important week for Old Masters, where we have some of the major auctions having their most important Old Master sales for New York. So it really, it was kind of an alternative to the centralized location version of an art fair. So it simultaneously cut costs for dealers because it means that they can show in their own spaces or show with dealers that they know that are based in New York. So if you're coming from London, you can show with a dealer based here, and really, you know, it's a much more affordable way for you to come to New York and show your pieces. And also gives you an opportunity to really have a exhibition that puts your best foot forward. So you have, you know, all the works that you really want to show and the space as you like it, as opposed to having a, you know, a fair environment where you get a stall and you have to fill it, and, you know, it's not really quite as
friendly.
Exactly. Yeah. So this really gives also people that are visiting an opportunity to talk to the dealers and have a really much more intimate visit with them, as opposed to kind of wandering through a big space.
Tent-like space.
Exactly. And it's, you know, and since 13 years ago, I came on about 3 years ago to help Chris Bean in New York, and because Margo has since retired. So my main push now is to help grow the fair, because obviously in 13 years, things have changed a bit. The collector base has changed slightly. It's become a bit more eclectic, a bit more diverse. So while the basis of Master Drawings was really to bring in curators and collectors and scholars who focus on drawing specifically, now it's really a mix of painting, sculpture, and drawings, and these, you know, mix of scholars and collectors that are coming in that are really interested in a wider swath of things. So now we have 30 dealers this year. And it's a really even split between U.S.-based and, well, actually New York-based, and then outside of New York and European-based.
Okay. So I just want to interject.
Sure.
So what I really like about the fair is the fact that it is in galleries, as opposed to a fair like a space, because it really connects people to the neighborhood.
Right.
And a lot of people don't realize that the Upper East Side used to be in New York City one of the early art districts.
Right.
And what made it special was because dealers were close to their patrons. Mm-hmm. And as the avenues were starting to build up with beautiful townhouses and then these luxury apartment buildings, it kind of formed a community. And then that kind of got lost a little bit. And the industry went further downtown.
Right.
And into Chelsea, where you have sort of these factory style buildings, warehouse buildings, nothing wrong with it, but it's a different vibe. It's a different feel. And now people are coming back to the Upper East Side.
Exactly.
It's affordable.
Mm-hmm.
It offers that sense of community. I'm very excited because a gallery that's not a part of your fair, but I've known her for a number of years, Lila Hella, is back on the Upper East Side now. And I was shocked, and I was like, oh, my God, Lila is uptown now, closer to where I live, and so I could visit a little bit more often. So I like that feel. And I think, isn't that a little bit like the London version? It's not like a white box space or
exactly.
a fair space, but it's neighborhood based.
Exactly. Yeah. It's in St. James and Mayfair in London. So it's a very similar feel. And the other thing is, you know, all of the major institutions are mostly on the east side in terms mm-hmm. of museum institutions.
Mm-hmm.
So you're also going back to, you know, we're next door to the Met.
Yes.
So that means having partnerships with these institutions is much more, you know, congenial because it's mm-hmm. right next door. So it's mm-hmm. really great. And that's similar in London, too. I mean, Sotheby's and Christie's are right next door or
okay.
in St. James and Mayfair. And you're not far from the British Museum and things like that. So, I mean, it's, you know, it's a similar kind of vibe where you're really returning to the historical center of where art was based, especially more traditional art.
And the other thing is, you know, like, for a long, long time, a lot of the big museums were not as friendly as they could be.
Sure.
Because it was primarily, you know, their philosophy that the museum should be this, you know, the space where works are to just be viewed, not to be touched. And you come there where someone would give a presentation, but there was still little interaction. And unless you were a collector, you felt a little intimidated by the environment mm-hmm. in and of itself. And that started to change, I would say, about 12 years ago, where the city of New York was really a part of that change. I'll never forget Kate Levin. She pushed a lot of museums saying, you got works in your archives, in your warehouses. You need to bring them out.
Mm-hmm.
You need to let people see them. You're on city property. You need to connect better with New Yorkers. And I don't think anyone had ever been that forthright with a lot of these museums. And they had to pause and think about it because even their demographics was changing. The collectors were aging. Their children were not as interested in the works that was being set aside for them. And so now you have this diversity that you didn't have before. And people are looking at the arts differently. They may not fully understand it, but they're looking at it. And when you have series like yours going on, it makes it more friendly, more accessible, and now people are starting to feel that it's not for the elites, but it's for everybody. Wouldn't you agree?
Yeah, absolutely. And that's really why we started to do a lot more partnerships in the past 3 years with museums. And we actually this year have a special loan exhibition from the Johnson Museum from Cornell. So they're bringing down about 25 pieces and exhibiting in a space uptown at Carlton Hobbs, which is on 93rd Street. And so it's actually a really great opportunity. It really does bring the museum to the neighborhood mm-hmm. in a way that's really very open, and anyone can come in and really talk to the curators about what's come down from Ithaca. Because really, you know, it's harder for people to go up to Ithaca
yes.
than it is for people to go to 93rd Street.
Right.
So we are really happy to be able to have an opportunity to really bring museums into the city that wouldn't otherwise have the opportunity to have people closely looking at their collection.
Now, the Carlton Hobb building, I believe it's an old mansion, correct?
Yes, exactly. Yeah, it was, I think it was the one of the early French Lycée, like early French schools. Mm-hmm. So it was.
I've been inside. Yeah. It's a gorgeous building.
It's a beautiful building. Yeah, absolutely.
Absolutely stunning.
Yeah. So we're really excited to have that on view. And, you know, we have another exhibition in there as well. That's Tommaso Brothers. And they were very nice to sponsor the exhibition. So it's it's not just that we're bringing these exhibitions down or into the city. It's also that the dealers are really interested in promoting and furthering the interaction between these institutions and what they're selling, and really mixing the commercial and the scholarly, which I think is really important, especially because, you know, the interest in Old Masters and, you know, we basically run from, at this point, antiquities to current. So
right.
We cover the full swath. So we really want to make sure that, you know, we're really giving equal coverage to artworks that wouldn't otherwise get as much attention.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we get a lot of coverage of contemporary and modern in New York, but we don't get as much Old Masters. And we get, you know, like the Leonardo.
Right.
We get very singular pieces, but we don't get a lot of really, you know, interesting exhibitions that involve pieces that are more esoteric and might not be as, you know, obvious as a Leonardo. So I think this is a really great week for people to really see things they wouldn't otherwise see and have someone there that can really talk about it.
And also works on paper, because a lot of your dealers, you know, focus on works on paper. That's more accessible when it comes to purchasing than a large painting. And so even though it could be small or it could be large, but it's on paper, people can actually start to, you know, believe that they can, you know, own one of these works and keep it in the family. And then it's not just about buying the works on paper. It's also about the framing.
Oh, yeah.
I tell people the framing can be just as important as the work itself.
Absolutely. And sometimes more expensive.
That's true, too. And so, therefore, it's the framing and seeing works in frames. You can change them. You can modify it. And it's also about lighting, how you want to present it. All of these nuances can actually encourage people to really think about collecting.
Absolutely. And even this year, we have a special exhibition from a new dealer that hasn't exhibited with us before that's on the cover of the brochure this year.
I love the cover.
So we have Pavel Zubok Fine Art, and they are exhibiting a sketchbook of Arshad Gorky. So it's actually very interesting to see how you even exhibit a sketchbook. So, you know, that's a very specific way of how do you display something that really was a working object for an artist and has so much intensity in it, and really conveys it well, both as an art object and a scholarly object. So there are things like that where it's really worth wandering around and kind of seeing what these dealers, how they put things together and really think about an inventive way of showing things.
Mm-hmm. And tell us some of the dealers who are going to be participating in Masters Drawings this year. I know Jill Newhouse is one.
Yes, absolutely. So I would say in terms of kind of overlap between London Art Week mm-hmm. and Master Drawings New York, we do have some overlap with especially the dealers that are pivotal board members. So we do have an advisory board as part mm-hmm. of Master Drawings New York. So Stephen Ongpin Fine Art is another one who comes here every year,
mm-hmm.
has a special exhibition associated with the fair, which is great, and shows a range of works that are beautiful. But this year we actually have about 12 new dealers.
Really?
So we have Otto Naumann's son, Ambrose Naumann, who opened his new gallery this year, which is great. So this is his first really foray into doing his own gallery space,
mm-hmm.
Young dealer, which is great. We have Robert Simon, who's a...
Oh, I love that place.
So he's exhibiting this year, and he's actually showing a contemporary artist and showing some contemporary drawings that are really based in the antique and looking back at historical drawings.
I have to stop and pause because I love Robert Simon's gallery because it's in a beautiful a building on the Upper East Side where they have a few
mm-hmm.
Dealers in that building. And I always thought that was smart of a lot of dealers on the Upper East Side. They would kind of, I wouldn't say that they did it on purpose, but I have a feeling people do talk. So you may have four or five dealers in a building that seems like an apartment building or a large townhouse type of building. And it's kind of smart because then it's by appointment only. It's in the setting like a person's home. And then they can secure, you know, their place very well and build it out as beautifully as they would like to, because Robert Simon's place is built out beautiful with the mantles, the color schemes, everything.
Absolutely.
And they can entertain you, and you feel like, oh, I can see this, you know, in my home. And but he does it over the top. I mean, he does it spectacularly. So I had to pause to give him, you know, a special shout out, because I love his gallery. He probably doesn't know who I am, but I love his gallery. So go ahead. Tell us about some others who are coming for the
first
time.
Sure, he appreciates the the positivity. We also have, I'm just looking at my list here. We have a great range of art of dealers this year. And, you know, some of our traditional dealers that have shown with us over the years are coming back. Marae Mosler is one. She's great. She shows Dutch Masters. And we have Didier Aron. And they're in a building similar to what you were saying, of multiple dealers in the same building. And also on the top floor of that building, Taylor Graham is showing.
It's
their second year showing. Finlay Galleries is actually our farthest south. They're on 57th Street, and they show a lot of American and European modern pieces. And they're hosting a young dealer this year. It's actually his first time in New York. He's a young Belgian dealer who's showing turn of the century Belgian work, beautiful things. But he's very young. He's 26, and it's his first time showing in New York. He's showing on his own. Amazing. So we're really proud of him for coming down. We hope he does well. And then we have, you know, W&K, who show, it's actually, they're on our tote bag this year. We have a Sheila on our tote bag, Egon Sheila.
I have to give him a special shout out too. I really do, because 2 years ago I brought some young interns and their teacher, and they were high school kids, and one of them was extremely nervous. I liked him very much. He was very, very nervous. So I took them to Master's Drawings, walked them around, and we went to his gallery, and he was so kind to them. He brought them in the bag. I said, no champagne, they're too young. And he showed them works, and he had like a Picasso, I believe, there. And they were just so like amazed, like, this is a real Picasso? I said, yes. And they were just so happy. And the teacher who came along, or rather like teacher mentor, came along, and he was so happy too. And it was like this really, you know, intimate moment where these four gentlemen are all talking together. And he turned to me, he says, bring more. He said, if you have more young people, just bring them. Just bring them. And I just thought he was so kind and so generous. So I have to give him such a shout out, because he's always pleasant, always gracious, and willing to teach people and share.
Right.
You know?
And I think you met with Robert Cachet. I'm sure that's who you were talking to. He's amazing. He's very welcoming and will really take the time to explain things to people that aren't familiar with the artworks on the wall. So absolutely worth visiting them. And just a couple more. I mean, W.M. Brady & Co., they're showing with Richard Feigen. And that's a really, you know, they're both really important dealers. And Mark Brady is a very important drawings dealer for New York. So we're happy to have him involved this year. But, you know, we have David Tunick. We have Kolnagy. David's been showing with us for quite some time now. So
well, he was on the show just a little while ago.
Oh, right, for IFPDA,
right?
Yes. So we have some overlap.
He had the Scream. He had several of it. We went, I went there, and I brought someone with me, and he was showing me everything. We were having a great time.
Yeah, no, he's he has some beautiful pieces. So this year has a beautiful cassatt, a Mary cassatt, so definitely worth having a look at. We have some amazing works on the wall and some really great dealers. So we hope that, you know, people will come by and really spend some time looking at these works.
And I know that, you know, the weather sometimes can scare people a little bit, but it's worth it. You know, just bundle up a little bit. And some of your dealers, they have light refreshments for people.
Absolutely.
So they can sit down and relax and talk and actually have conversation. So it's a wonderful way for spending the afternoon in New York City, which is very different from Chelsea, because in Chelsea it's different. You kind of have to walk through and walk out. It's not, you know, conducive for a lot of conversation. So it's a different vibe, a different feel, kind of, you know, set in time, and, you know, for lack of a better term, and you get to enjoy yourself.
Absolutely. And, you know, we also are offering tours this year. We're partnering with Drawing New York, which is another organization based in New York City that mostly focuses on actually practicing drawing and mm-hmm. you know, figure studies and things like that. Mm-hmm. But we're leading tours with them. So throughout the weekend, we're having free tours offered to people that would like really people to take them to the spaces. We're doing it geographically, so sort of, you know, the lower quadrant and then kind of working uptown. So mm-hmm. if anyone's interested in coming, you know, please visit our website and sign up for some tours.
Okay. Well, now tell us a little bit about yourself and how you decided to get in all of this. Now, I know that, you know, because you're rather young. You're, you know, 32 now?
31.
Going on 32.
Exactly.
And Brooklyn-based.
Exactly. Greenpoint. Yeah.
Oh, okay. And you're an art dealer as well as a painter.
Correct. At this point, I'm doing a bit more art dealing than painting. It's, you know, it's hard to do both. But mostly what I do is help collectors with managing their collections. So I will work closely with collectors on archiving their works, but also if they want to sell things or acquire new things, I'll assist them with that. And I'm also an appraiser, so I will appraise works if clients come to me for that. So I do a range of things beyond master drawings.
Okay. All right. And what I saw a couple of your works, they have sort of a surrealist sort of feel to them, wouldn't you say?
Yeah, they're
assemblage,
yeah,
sort of.
They're, I call them portraits, but they're really images of figures kind of fully wrapped in cloth. Mm-hmm. And it's meant to kind of be a play on how the artist really does have control over the sitter. Mm. And can really, you know, almost undermine the sitter's appearance by covering them with all of their clothes. But their clothes really do represent who they are.
Okay. Yeah. All right. Well, that's kind of true. It's a personal statement.
Exactly. Exactly.
And so you're a graduate of RISD.
Correct.
I love that school.
Great
and
school.
You also got your master's in London. And the name of the school is Courtauld?
Correct.
Courtauld.
Yes.
Courtauld Institute mm-hmm. of Art. And how was that experience for you?
It was great. You know, I studied Northern Renaissance painting there, which is a little bit different from studying actual painting. Mm-hmm. But I loved it. It was a great school to go to, and I loved being in London. And I will say that, you know, anyone who's considering getting a master's degree in art history, you know, going to London for school is great because you have access to, you know, mainland Europe and really can see a lot there. And it's a very different type of experience. It's much more directed towards a single subject as opposed to doing a broader study of art history. So, you know, we really did a lot of focus on 1380 to 1520, which is a very, you know,
okay,
specific time period. But I really loved going there. And I've, you know, since built a very strong relationship with the gallery there. They have a very amazing art gallery as part of the institution. And they're actually closed for the next 4 years.
Really?
Yeah, they're redoing the entire building. But it's really worth visiting if you're in London in 4 years to see the gallery.
Well, there's a U.S., I should say not U.S., New York-London connection that's actually building and growing because you got Frieze that comes in every year, Master's Drawings that's coming in. And then you have other dealers who are thinking about coming to New York. You have Asia Week coming up. You have Tribal Arts that's in May. And so you're getting a lot of London-based, but also some Paris-based, Dutch-based galleries saying, let's give New York a try. And I think it's been very successful, hasn't it?
Yeah, I think definitely. And there are certain times of the year, mm-hmm. definitely, where it's worth being in New York. And I think a lot of dealers are kind of using the times of the year that suit them best to be mm-hmm. here. And you see a lot of people forming partnerships with galleries that are based here permanently and saying, okay, I'm like, for instance, W&K Gallery, they're based in Vienna, mm-hmm. But they show with Shepherd Gallery. Mm-hmm. So Robert Cachet is actually Shepherd Gallery. So they have a partnership where they do exhibitions where they share, mm-hmm. right? So W&K will come to New York during Master Drawings. They also show at TFAF. Mm-hmm. So, you know, they're kind of, they'll show mixed exhibitions, and it's a really great way for dealers to show in New York without necessarily putting just their own shingle up, but really forming something with someone else. But you do have a lot of galleries coming in directly from London and from Paris and from Holland and really starting their own thing here.
Well, it kind of, you know, makes people think, you know, or actually, you know, remind them that New York City is an international city. It's not just an American city. It's an international city. People come here not just to live, but they want to present. And when they think of presenting, they think of coming to New York. It's the place you want to be. You want to be surrounded by all of the energy, the people, the chaos, and it actually adds to what they're trying to do.
Absolutely.
I think this is great. So I just want to say thank you so much for coming. This is the first time you've interviewed with me. I've had Crispian on twice before. I love him. He's great. He's phenomenal. But it's great to have you here and to know there's now a new person in New York that's orchestrating Master's Drawings. And I wish you guys all the very best.
Thank you so much for having me. And it was lovely to talk with you.
You're welcome. Bye-bye.